Very, very good evening to all of you. On behalf of the International Council for School Leadership, I welcome all the educators and school leaders from across India and Middle East to join us on the first Education Convo in our Friday at 5 series, which is going to be a weekly series. I thank Dr. Ritu Chandra, who is an assistant professor at NCRT, Mrs. Lata Vaidyanathan, a legendary educationist of India, Mrs. Sangeeta Krishnan, who was the head of curriculum and training at Bharti Foundation, for agreeing to share their views, the research, what the experiences in policy making, and also in leading schools with all of us. I especially want to welcome Dr. Boria Majumdar for joining us. Dr. Majumdar is a doctorate in history from Oxford University, and most of us know him as the leading sports journalist of India. Now, as we all prepare ourselves to deal with the disruptions caused by COVID-19, the National Education Policy has also been released. Now, this has compounded our anxieties towards the future of our students, our schools, and also our careers. We do not know what the future holds for all the stakeholders and the education system. But one thing is definitely sure, and all of us know that, and that is the reason why on a Friday evening at 5 o'clock, we have more than, right now we have 218 people who have already joined us. We all know in the depth of our hearts that school education is poised to change, and it's going to change in unbelievable ways, in unimaginable ways. For me personally, I feel that this is the year, 2020 is the year, when historical changes would come. In almost all aspects of education. So it's really the time for us as school leaders, as educators, to contribute to the future of education and play a part when the history of school education is about to be rewritten. Our focus should not just be on how do we survive or how do we manage. Our outlook should be how do we play a significant role in the future of school education. Now, the National Education Policy is a very comprehensive document. It looks at reforming almost every aspect of school education, and we all would have gone through it. And we all understand that it is not possible for us to either understand or explain to somebody the complete impact of National Education Policy in a two-hour session. It's just not. I know there are a lot of, you know, webinars going on where we talk about decoding NEP in a two-hour session, but really it's not practically possible to do that. So what ICSL thought, that the change of this magnitude, which we are about to see, needs to be understood by each one of us, not just read, but studied. So there's a big difference between reading a policy and studying a policy. And if you really want to study the policy, we will have to focus on specific clauses of the policy and discuss them fully. And that's the reason why we came up with Friday at 5, so that we all can commit one day of the week, 90 minutes, to come together on a regular basis. And over the period of time, we can understand the policy so well that we can explain it to our teachers, and we can explain it to our management, we can explain it to our colleagues in education. Let me just explain briefly before we begin how the convo works. So all of us are aware of the flipped classroom model. It's pretty much the same model. We would expect that all the people who are attending the convo have read the policy, and they have some questions and they have some concerns, or they have certain opinion about it. At the time of registration, we would invite participants to speak up, tell us their views, and we would give everybody 3 minutes to put their views across. And I would encourage all of you to pose some questions, because no question is smaller than the other. I think that's really important, that all our questions need to be answered. So you put your questions through, we'll give you 3 minutes to speak up. Raise your concern, whether it's positive or negative, it doesn't matter. We are a political body. Our only focus is exchange of knowledge, and the exchange of knowledge that helps all of us grow together. So whether you want to throw NEP or you don't like certain aspects of NEP, this is the place for you to talk about. And once we have taken the views of certain people, in the second half, we would expect our experts to give their opinion, share their experiences, clarify some of the comments that have been made, answer some of the questions that have been done. So that's the format. You as a participant are more important, and you need to be actively involved in the convo. If I interrupt you after your 3 minutes and I mute you and move on to the next participant, please don't hate me. That's my job, and I need to do my job just to make sure that we get to hear everybody. So please be very crisp, very pointed, and just put your question across. Now with that, let me begin this, and the way we are going to flow through this program, we'll have the first half, then we will have Dr. Ritu Chandra explaining the NCRT, not the official, but her role in the NCRT, because she has been actively involved in some parts. So we'll invite her. Then we'll invite Sangeeta Krishnanji to share her views. Then we'll have Mrs. Lata Vaidyanathan to share her experiences. And in the end, I would request Dr. Boria Majumdar to say a few words on how he sees this big change evolving and coming, and his own experiences in policy and change. So without wasting any bit of time, let me just quickly invite some of you. We will unmute you and you can talk. I can see Dr. Amrita Vora. So ma'am, do you want to start? You will have to unmute. Yeah, go ahead, ma'am.
Okay, so the best part of the policy, and thank you for letting me start. So the first thing to be said here about early childhood geared education is that it's been a long, long time this was due. And thankfully, finally, early childhood education is a recognized entity in policy and in every possible way in our country, and it's being widely talked about. So that's a very, very welcome step. India is the country where it may have been put into policy now. We've had Anganwadis, we've had lots and lots of progressive schools, though when we look at the percentage of children impacted by that, that may be minuscule. But then there is a lot of really good work happening in the progressive schools. India is the place where the Montessori system actually originated. And I think early childhood education and care is being taken care of very well. It's a very wide area of research. Every country has to look into this, looking at James Hackman's curve and understanding it that way. So my question very quickly is that given that we have already got such a rich set of expertise in the country, are the policymakers going to ensure that for continuous development, continuous professional development, I mean, really this resource pool is going to be utilized and utilized effectively? And how is this sector really going to be benefited and helped? You know, the private and the public really need to work together. So what is in the policy which is going to ensure that, you know, some kind of collaboration comes through between the public and the private domains here?
I think that's a very, very good point, because the policy does not talk about public-private partnership. And I think that's one aspect that India would need. Let me move on to, thank you very much. Please allow me that I don't have to thank and introduce everybody, because that will take 20% of my time away. So I'll just say, you know, thank you to all of you in a common email. We have Alka Sahani with us. Alka, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here. Am I audible?
Yes, you're audible.
Yeah, good evening, everyone. And as I am going to, you know, reciprocate what Amrita said, yes, policy is great. But when it comes to the early education, I still have my doubts. And my question would be to the panel would be, you know, we all know that early learning matters. It is the foundation years for the students. Now the kids, we have 1 year extra with us. Are we really equipped, especially when we talk about the rural areas? We are talking about Anganwadis. You know, we are talking about equity. We are talking about access. So would we be able to, you know, give justice? Are we going to do justice to all the students? Is the policy going to assure that? With 1 year extra, you know, that is for rural areas, Anganwadis. If I talk about urban, the progressive schools, we have preschools, you know, mushrooming almost in every household. Every third or fourth household has a preschool these days. So are the preschools going to ensure that we are giving quality education so that these students, when they come to us in the senior schools, you know, there is no gap and there is a smooth transition? How are we going to ensure that smooth transition, especially when 1 year has increased in the preschool link? Thank you. Atul, I'm... Hello?
Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, that is majorly my question. How would we be able to do justice to that? Are our teachers would be equipped for that, especially in Anganwadis when we talk about... And in urban areas, when you talk about the preschools, they hire all the fresh graduates who are not well-trained. So how are we going to ensure that we are providing quality education, especially when a year has increased in the preschooling now? We have one more year with us. We have to ensure the well-being of the students as well, along with the equity and access. So how, you know, we are going to ensure that when these students come to the senior schools, there is a smooth transition? That is my question. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much. Thank you, ma'am. Shabana Rehan, can we have this? Shabana Rehan, please.
Hello, sir. Good evening. Good evening, everybody.
Good evening, ma'am. Go ahead, sir.
Yes, I totally agree with what ma'am has said just now. Are we going to have justice regarding this? Because the aim of this policy is to attain optimal outcomes in the domains of physical and motor development and regarding cognitive development and socio-emotional ethical development. And regarding all these things, we are going to prepare the children for the primary classes. So I just wanted to know, okay, how can we assess the development and learning of the children? And what is the role of the CCE teacher in this? Are we going to train our teachers regularly for this purpose? This is the only question I want to know, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much. I think the points that you have raised are very, very valid. I hope Lata ma'am, Sangeeta ji, and Ritu ji are making a note of this because they're going to be very good questions that I can see. We just have three of them, but I can bet it's going to get better. Do we have Neelima Kamra on with us?
Yes, sir. I'm there.
Ma'am, please go ahead.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Atul ji, for this platform. I would like to, as all of us know, that National Education Policy is very, very flexible and trying to give us a multidisciplinary and interdisciplinary approaches to the curriculum. Rather, it is removing the boundaries between the sports and the academics, vocational and co-curricular activities. It is giving us a rounded citizen also in turn. Again, a very valid point raised by National Education Policy is that we should teach our students in our mother tongue when they are in primary. And I fully endorse that. Even the qualitative researches agree with that. But my concern is when we are in metro cities, how we are going to do that when we have one child from Gujarat, another from Haryana, third from Punjab, and fourth from another state. So how to balance the multiple languages in one single classroom, or how we teach them with one single language?
Ma'am, that's a very valid question. We're going to be talking about this in more detail when we talk about the multilingual aspect of the policy. However, I think for this particular webinar, I would request that we stick to ECCE primarily. The other thing I want to comment is, Neelimaji, that the policy actually mentions a very key word, wherever possible. So there is no compulsion for a private school for example, Kendriya Vidyalayas have already taken a stand that they will be not instructing in mother tongue, they will be using English. So I think that would happen across India, and you will have the right to choose the language of instruction. Do we have Mrs. Satnam Kaur with us? Okay, do we have Dinesh Subaru with us? Okay, do we have Murthy with us? Murthy MVSS?
Yes, sir, yes.
Murthy ji, please go ahead with your remark.
Sir, with respect to this early childhood education, my question is, where are these teachers being trained? Do we have, what are the authorized training centers? Like B.Ed. colleges or, primary teacher education thing. The Anganwadis and all are also not actually trained to teach. They are basically working on nutrition and all other aspects of the physical well-being. But my question is, availability of trained personnel, how are we going to face it? This is what I want to know.
Great. Thank you. And that's a very big concern. We'll definitely address that. The experts will address that. Do we have Sita Lakshmi ji?
Yes.
Go ahead, please.
This is Sita Lakshmi. I have always felt that if we give importance to preschool education, we'll be able to work on the rest of the school in a much better manner. The first time I think the Government of India has taken a lot of initiative on this. And as others have pointed out, it is not just enough to think of, line of inquiry at the preschool level. But we have to initiate the steps required for training teachers. We have to, Montessori is an excellent methodology to be followed. It works on all aspects of the child. It brings in how to handle differentiated education in the classroom. But if we are not able to take it the right way, then again, teachers are going to follow the earlier kindergarten pattern where, you know, something was given just to satisfy the parents and a lot of writing was happening. The skills were not getting developed. So a lot of stress has to be given to training the teachers to ensure that their communicative ability is taken care of. And that would lead to success of the entire program, because the entire school's foundation lies with what is called at the preschool level. And this has to be really addressed very seriously.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. I think that's a very valid point. Because if we don't really bring this to action, then there's no point writing it on a piece of paper.
Yes.
Do we have Ira Vishwakarma with us? Do we have Lakshmi Prakash with us? Okay, we have Monica Ahuja Rao. Do we have Mr. Naresh Sharma with us? Do we have Swarnima Luthra Ji with us? Okay, good. So now I'm going to put the... do we have Priyanka Sharma with us? Okay, so now I'm going to put the floor open. Let me just see if anybody has put their hand up for a question. Because these were some of the questions that we had received. And I think some of the questions that I'm seeing here are repetition of what we have been talking about. Do we have Jyoti Saxena ji here? I think she wrote a question here.
Yes, sir. Yeah. I'm Jyoti Saxena. I'm from Calcutta.
Go ahead with your question.
Yes, sir. So my question is, like, I've already written in the chat box. The policy, you know, definitely is, you know, the future of our young generation. And we have been waiting for this for a very, very long time. But my only apprehension is this, that till now we have been preparing our children for skills and jobs, you know, those that will be redundant maybe after 5 years or maybe 10 years. And so this NEP focused on acquiring that new skills? And what is the roadmap to prepare our young generation for the future jobs and challenges? And it has to start from the kindergarten. We cannot wait for them to grow up to 8 and then think, you know, what are the skills and what are the challenges, you know, which the future generation has to face. So what is that roadmap which has been, you know, is it there? And if it is there, then what is that roadmap?
Thank you very much, ma'am.
Thank you.
And we have Isha Shonik. Yeah, go ahead, ma'am. Isha Shonik. Swarnima, ma'am, go ahead, please.
Very good evening to everyone. And thanks, Atulji, for inviting me. I feel the policy that has come up, it's really a long-awaited one. And especially for EC, I would say that since NCRT, it's written there, NCRT is going to frame the curriculum for 0 to 3. My question is that whether it would be really like that, because 0 to 3 means the parent would be handling all the affairs in that particular age group, 0 to 3. So what kind of curriculum are we expecting, since ma'am is there from NCRT, if she could throw the light on that. Thank you.
I will definitely, I think she will do that. Ashima Jairath, do you want to put your comment?
Yes. Good evening, yes. Everybody. It's a pleasure to be here. I have one basic question, that is, how is the NCRT going to be tackling, one, the training of the teachers who are going to be looking now after the foundation level, which is from nursery to grade 2? That's the first question. And how are they going to tackle with the strength that is there in each class? Normally in some private as well as public schools, and of course the government schools, the strength in each class is really high. So when you're talking of a curriculum which is going to be a thematic taught together. So how is the government going to tackle that?
I'm also here, Isha Shonik. I reacted a little late.
Not a problem, ma'am. Go ahead.
My question has actually already been raised by a lot of people. And I would like to re-emphasize the difference between the rural and the urban. The requirement is different. So the curriculum, I think, should cater for that. And the main thing is that our teachers need a lot of support and training. So if that doesn't happen, then nothing is successful. Policies are all very good, and this is also very good. But implementation is what I'm looking at, and I would want to know how they plan the implementation.
Good
evening, Anoop sir. I also want to say something.
Go ahead. Yes.
Okay, thank you, Anoop. Thank you so much, sir, for providing the opportunity. And sir, actually, this NEP 2020 pushes much desired reforms, but the challenge lies in implementation. Like the NEP is not a law in itself, rather it is more of a framework for creating laws. The government will need to pass legislation to various aspects of the NEP, and lawmakers will need to strongly consider how private funding of education can be improved. And so they can either allow for much greater flexibility for institutions to raise, invest, and create a corpus fund that can be used for research and educational purposes. Or, sir, they should consider allowing private for profit investment in education. Only then we can be closer to realizing our goals of better quality education for all. So I think that's my question, whether we are going to implement it successfully as it is framed very beautifully, and it was really very much desired. This type of education policy is really wonderful. But the question is its implementation. Thank you so much, sir.
Yes, sir. Mr. Jain, please go ahead.
Atul, my anxiety is that this 0 to 3 years should be left to the mothers, grandmothers, and the family. I think we should not intervene in what is natural instinct and how we all have been raising our children and taking care of the in the initial stages. Next, my anxiety is that these examinations, 3, 5, and 8 class, they will put a lot of pressure on our students, children and teachers. And teachers will be teaching only for the examinations. And there will be private tuitions, coaching centers, and all these things will definitely are going to. So I think CCTV can be practiced up to class 8 in a very professional manner. If the teachers are trained, and we have a lot of training, and we all already have the experience of doing it when CC was there in up to class 10. So, and the foundational course also in the first 3 years and then another 2 years is also a question mark, that what kind of foundation we are going to lay to 3-year-olds, 4-year-olds, because again, they should be naturally allowed to grow. And this directional or too much regulated growth right from so much early. You see, the pre-primary schools are all right. But beyond that, if it comes from the NCRT, and India being such a vast country, and there are cities, and there are tribal areas and villages and all that. So I think this should also be left to the local people. So the examination should not be there. They should be eliminated completely, because we had been talking 5-10 years ago that there should not be any examinations, and this pressure, that pressure. So this stress should be removed. And then the teacher training part is also a big question mark. And this 0 to 3 part, and then the foundational course should also be made easy. A lot of this language part and mathematical skills right at too early a stage is perhaps, to my mind, not correct. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for putting that question. Anita Vadhera ji, would you like to, you have a question, I think. Well, her question was, what will be the...
Good evening, sir. good evening for this platform, and it is too good like we all are here. So my question is, like, there is some apprehension in our minds in all the principals, and we are discussing that also. Like, will the entry level be changed? Like, is it going to be 3+ only, or do we need to have another year in the schooling?
So will another additional year of schooling?
What will be the entry level in our formal schooling? Like, will it be the same as it is going on right now?
Okay. I think that can be addressed.
Yes, yes. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Aditi Roy ji.
Yes, sir. Good evening, everyone. My question one already has been raised. The 0 to 3 years, what kind of approach is NCERT thinking of giving to our parents? When we consider the vast scale where we are considering Anganwadi and all the rural areas also, how is it NCERT is going to give us a detailed approach on that? And the second question is, as it says that till classes 5, there's a standard 5 or till standard 8, mother tongue is going to be a very important, part of it. Education can be done through mother tongue also. Now, we are trying to bring in foreign universities also. So will not the English language development be a little delayed for our kids? Won't that later on be be a question mark on our kids? Won't our kids be behind the students of the entire world if we are considering? So this is these are the two questions I have.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. We have Himani Mittal with us. Himani Mittal, do you want to ask your question?
Yeah, thanks. My question, a lot of part of the questions have already been put up. However, teacher training is one of the concerns. Another concern I have is that NEP very beautifully lays down the NEP beautifully lays down the foundational years. However, as per my understanding of the kindergarten and early childhood preschools that I have been visiting, they don't have a set curriculum. Everybody is following a different kind of a curriculum, and to the extent that some preschools, just to satisfy the parents' quest and say that, yeah, mere bachche ko itna aata hai, mere bachche ko itna aata hai, they go way beyond the required curriculum for the kindergarten, for the preschoolers. So now when I add 3 language and all the other skills, so the schools might just start adding up, piling up on what they're already doing. So will we have a very defined curriculum? A defined curriculum, and NEP talks of a framework, pedagogical framework, but there's not a mention of a properly designed curriculum for early childhood, which is much needed.
Okay, I think Ritu has been working on early childhood curriculum, and I think when she speaks, she is definitely going to touch this aspect because that's very close to her heart. Can we have Sunanda Mishra ji, please? Do we have Sunanda Mishra with us? Sangeeta Prashar ji?
Sir, good evening.
Sunanda ji, please go ahead.
Yeah. Sir, basically my concern was regarding the parents' approach for as the NEP has laid down that 0 to 3, the parents are going to teach the children. So what are they looking at exactly? That was my main question to how the parents are going to address to these very vital years of a child.
Okay, great. So I think we can address that. When we start answering, Bharti Sanamani ji. We have Bharti Sanamani with us.
Yes, good evening to one and all. I have a question and a concern. Actually, I'm speaking from Sharjah, of course.
Great, welcome. You're the first speaker from Sharjah right now.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for that. I've been hearing a lot about rural, urban, and I have been I have a keen interest in learning more and understanding more of India at Indian level. And yes, we as expats, we have some knowledge extra, whatever we have, we can give. I know people over there have got a lot of knowledge about it. But we are trying to adapt here early years, and we as teachers know about early years foundation state. And we have been trained in that because here inspection is very important, and we as teachers in, you can even take the help of all the Indian teachers who are here. That's from my side, whoever is interested can give. Yes, and there were some concerns like mother tongue, which I have. I don't know how it is going to work in NCERT and CBSE because we are working for CBSE schools over here. That is one concern. And yes, as you said, we can go ahead with the English language because all the schools, Kendriya Vidyalayas are having English, so we'll opt for, we will opt for English language. Yeah, that is that concern was clear. And other concern which I came to know and I understood is the curriculum which we have. Curriculum as a whole, you know, the whole India as such, or a CBSE, there is state level, there are state level boards, there are CBSE boards, there are IGCSE boards, you know, through all. And when it is NEP, when it comes to NEP, National Education Policy, how are they going to blend it, and how, what will be our objectives for each at not only in the early years, in primary level, how are we going to adapt it?
Oh, great. So thank you very much. I think that is a good time for us to stop. I think we have had a very nice range of inputs from practicing school leaders as well as teachers. We also have people from overseas speaking about it. And I'm very sure that our experts would have taken the pointers to discuss their views on this. So without wasting much time, I would like to invite Dr. Ritu Chandra, Assistant Professor NCERT, to share her views. And incidentally, I'll tell you what happened when we were doing our research on early childhood development in India. I, in fact, came across one of the research papers written by Dr. Chandra in 1997. And when I read the paper, I think it very nicely portrayed the challenges in early childhood that India as a whole was facing. A lot of data, a lot of good quality data was collected from multiple states. And the paper also made certain recommendations in terms of what actions India should be taking. And when I was reading that, I could see a reflection of that paper in the National Education Policy. And that is when I began to try to track her down. And she was very nice and she was very supportive. Now, we need to understand that she is here in the capacity of a researcher from NCERT and not really a spokesperson of NCERT. So whatever she's sharing with us is her research, her involvement in various initiatives, and her experiences. So ma'am, could you please address, we have right now 365 people on us on this platform. Could you please go ahead and share your views? Dr. Ritu Chandra, I think
I'm mute. Because this is actually, I hardly use Zoom, so I'm very well versed with the Google Meet, and I was into the Ayushman Bharat, the Government of India's a big program has been launched yesterday. So I was part of it. So, the process that is there, mind is there. So, Zoom we don't use usually, but I'm happy to see that connectivity is very good in Zoom. So, I'm really happy to see that more than 300 participants and the teachers, I can say the leaders, those who are leading the new generation are here, and that's really very encouraging. And I've heard many questions they have asked. I think all the questions with on each and every paragraph of the national education policy they have tried to cover, and I think from one paragraph they have 10 questions. I think many people could not ask questions, so that's really very encouraging, because it's good that now people have started reading, not only the teachers but the parents also. I'm getting a lot of queries from the parents also, so that's one thing that is very, very important and encouraging also. Sir, ek important baat hai that I have not written paper in 1997, because that time I was in class 10th.
Okay.
It's 1917. So 2017.
Yes, you are absolutely right. I'm, see, yes. 1997, even I was in college.
I was in 10th standard. I just completed 10th standard.
Right, 2017. So let me stand corrected.
So that people can easily download it. It's if you even write the quality ECC, that paper will come, because it is a most searched paper at the international level even. So that time I was doing a PhD, and I thought I should go for this kind of paper, searching first what is happening in early childhood education. Not only early childhood education, but early childhood care and education is very, very important. Because in 2013 and 14, during those 2 years, the Ministry of Women and Child Development has come up with 3 important documents that everybody knows about it. The quality standards and the education policy, national policy on early childhood education. This is the title, exact title of that document. And apart from that, national ECC curriculum framework was developed. So I thought, let's see. What is the ground scenario that is there at the national level, that is actually what is in the paper, in these documents, and what is happening at the grassroots level. So uski parity dekhne ke liye kiya tha. So I picked up all 4, all 8 quality standards which are given in the national ECC quality standards that were developed by the Ministry of Women and Child Development. So uske according, I tried to collect the different studies done by various big institutions and ministries also. So almost 33 education research papers I could collect, those which were available on the internet, and which were conducted after 2000, because at that time the Dakar framework and our monitoring reports, global monitoring reports, GMR, you might have heard the GMRs, that have started coming. So that was basically a time, 2000, year 2000, when a lot of emphasis has been started giving to early childhood education internationally. And India was also a part of it. So we have also started working very seriously on the aspects which were focused in the GMR and through the Dhaka framework also. So that is why this was the reason that I have taken those studies which were conducted after 2000. So sir ne jaise bataya, even that time I was not aware that this new education policy is going to come, these kind of recommendations will be done. So very, very honestly, I have tried to analyze what studies are saying, and I have compiled, and also I have seen what different policy documents like policy on early childhood education and curriculum framework and standards, and also CABE reports, which are very, very important report, which is very, very important report by the Ministry of Human Resource Development. So just usko koshish ki dekhne ki kitni parity hai और कितना हम अभी तक अचीव कर पाए हैं, व्हाट इज द रियल स्टेटस. उसके बाद आई फॉरगॉट अबाउट दिस पेपर, बिकॉज दिस वाज अ रिक्वायरमेंट फॉर पीएचडी ओनली. एंड देन सर हैज इन्फॉर्म्ड मी दैट मोस्ट ऑफ द रिकमेंडेशन दैट यू हैव गिवन इन योर पेपर इज एक्चुअली रिफ्लेक्टेड इन द न्यू एजुकेशन पॉलिसी. सो अब कल ही मैंने देखा, और आई फाउंड दैट मोस्ट ऑफ द रिकमेंडेशंस आर रियली very much there in my paper. So I'm really happy, and thank you Dr. Nishal for informing me about this. So I think aapke jo questions hain, these are really very valid questions, and jaisa unhone kaha, I am here as a researcher, And I'm also working in NCRT as an assistant professor and very much in early childhood education, because I'm an assistant professor in early childhood care and education. And since 14 years, I'm there in NCRT working in this particular area. So, ek-ek karke question chalte hain, hum badhte hain, lekin the most important thing, that most of the questions are basically related to one important aspect. Number one, quality. Everybody is concerned about the quality. So quality ke liye, there are certain parameters. So we have to work on the provisions. We have to work on the system. And also we need to work on the process. So jab hi aapke jitne bhi questions hain, main isi terms mein dene ki koshish karungi. Because when you say provisions, the provisions are not in the hands of NCERT. So aap agar mujhe NCERT ka samajh ke question pooch rahe hain, then I will be able to answer the question which are basically related to the process, because we are very much into the developing the material for the training of the teachers, and also we are going giving the trainings, and we are also doing the researches. Provision ki jahan baat aati hai, that is basically a area of the ministry and the policy level. So we can recommend the that these things should be there, but these are the policy decisions which are related to the system as well as provisions. So provision and system is not in the hands of NCERT, but everything is written very well in the new education policy. Aur ek baat jo aapko main batana chahti hu, don't get confused by what is written in the new education policy. Ministry has already started working with other ministries also, and with the NCERT, with NCTE, with NIOS. There are different partners which are working together. They have started working right after this new education policy, as well as before that they were also working together. But now we have a roadmap in the form of the policy. So abhi jaise aap bar bar keh rahe hain ki implementation ka issue aata hai, so implementation ke liye hi, that is why this is what we are doing. We are developing a roadmap. वो बहुत जल्द आपके पास आ जाएगा. तो जितने भी कंसर्न आपने बताए हैं, दीज ऑल आर गोइंग टू बी एड्रेस्ड. तो सबसे पहला जो आपका बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट कंसर्न है, दैट इज अगेन रिलेटेड टू द प्रोसेस, इज अ करिकुलम. तो आप कह रहे हैं व्हाट इज द करिकुलम. सो करिकुलम हैज ऑलरेडी बीन डेवलप्ड इन 2019 बाय द एनसीईआरटी. द करिकुलम फ्रेमवर्क वॉज डेवलप्ड बाय द मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ वुमेन एंड चाइल्ड डेवलपमेंट इन 2013. The soft copy is available on the internet. Agar abhi bhi aap Google karenge, you will get the original copy of the new education policy, national policy on early childhood education, as well as national early childhood education care and education curriculum framework developed by the ministry. So agar aap usko download karna chahe, you can download it right now. Based on the policy, early childhood education policy, as well as quality standards developed by the MWCD, and also the National Early Childhood Care and Education Curriculum Framework. These three documents, I told you earlier that these three documents were developed by the Ministry of Women and Child Development. Based on all the recommendations given in those three documents, NCERT has developed a curriculum in 2019. The soft copy is also available. Hard copy you can purchase from the NCERT's publication division. You can go and you can place an order also. So hard copy is available both in Hindi and English. So those who are in the Hindi speaking states, they can purchase that. Those who are in the English speaking state, they can also purchase that. If you need a soft copy, I can provide that also. Everything is free, so you can download that. So this is the latest information. Now your question was that whether there should be, because most of the schools, they have the private schools, they have 2 years of free preschool education. Am I right?
Yes.
But in there's 3 years of preschool education there. But wherever in the government sector, wherever there is a pre-primary center, it is only for 1 year, because the 11th and 12th 5-year plans, they have categorically recommended that at least there should be 1 year of school readiness program or a pre in the form of pre-primary centers in all the primary schools. So looking at that recommendation, all the almost all the primary schools, especially in Delhi, they've started 1 year of pre-primary. Lekin private mein ye pehle se hi 2 saal ka tha. But we were also waiting for the recommendation from the new education policy that says that you should have at least 3 years of pre-primary education, and you can call it as a pre-primary education or maybe as a preschool education. All are same. But the point is very important that you should have 3 years of preschool education. Now you will ask a question that age of admission in Delhi and some other states is 5+ in class 1. So how is it possible that we should have a 3 years of preschooling? Is it a question? I think this will be a question from all of you because everybody is facing the same problem. So the policy clearly says that when the child is 6+, then the child should be in class 1. That means somehow after sometime they are going to change this 5+ enrollment of class 1 enrolling the 5+ child in a class 1 to 6+. Like if you go to Punjab, the age of admission is 6+. But in Rajasthan, it is 6+ also. And in some schools, it is 5+ also. Because they have given a kind of flexibility to the school. That is again, which is not, I think, acceptable thing. So as per the Right to Education Act, actually it should be 6+. Then only we can justify that, yes, we have 3 years of pre-primary education. And then, aur wo pre-primary education kab ki hai, aap dekhiye. New education policy also says 3+, it should be 3+, 4+, and 5+. So, aapka bacha jab 3 saal ka ho jayega, 3 saal ek din ka bhi, then the child will be in preschool 1. 4+ ka hoga, to preschool 2. Usko aap naam kuch bhi de sakte hain. Aap naam dete hain usko nursery, then KG 1, KG 2, ya lower KG and upper KG kehte hain aap usko. Whatever nomenclature you can use, you are free to use it. But as a NCRT, what NCRT recommends is that you should call it as a PS1, that is preschool 1, if the child is enrolled in at the age of 3+. It is preschool 2 for 4+, and preschool 3 is for 5+. And this clearly indicates that when the child is 6+, the child should be in class 1. So, ye age ka aapka clear ho gaya question? If you have any query?
I think very well explained, ma'am. I think it should be
now, clear. Now, your question was like learning outcome. And I think a few of you have asked that what should be, how we are going to develop the competency and how we are going to check the level of the children, if they have really achieved it or not. So for this, if you go through, please, I request you to please download our curriculum of NCERT. And if you go through that curriculum, you will find that we have predefined key concepts age-wise. That means if the child is 3+ age, the child should be enrolled in preschool 1, right? So when the child is in preschool 1 and the child is 3+, there will be certain key concepts which are based on the competencies. You will expect the parents and the teachers are expected to ensure that these should be imbibed in children. They should be taught like that these skills should be, or key concepts should be there in the child. So we have predefined those key concepts, and based on those key concepts, we had developed certain exemplar pedagogical processes. Those pedagogical processes are actually exemplar in nature. Teacher is free to develop, because what happens whenever we don't give such pedagogical processes, teachers without understanding, because some teachers are really very good, they are well trained, but what happens when there is a mushrooming of the preschool centers and even in the government sectors, if the teachers are not interested, actually they don't use the pedagogy that is not age and developmentally appropriate. So looking at that problem, we have given an as example some of the pedagogy, so the teacher will be able to understand that yes, these kind of processes, we pedagogical processes, we need to follow when we deal with the 3+8 children. Suppose, for example, puzzles. So in case the child is 3+ age, usko aap 8 set ka agar puzzle dete hai, the child will not be able to do it. So you have to start with 3 set puzzle, so the child will easily be able to do it. Agar bachcha ko kar pata hai, then you can go for 4 set, then 5 set, and then 6 set. It depends. But in general, you should go with the 3 or 4 set puzzle. So ye hui pedagogy. When the child is 4+, so there will be of no use when you use 3+ set of puzzle. So you have to go for more complex set of puzzles. Similarly, for 5+, your objective will be totally different.
It will be a test, and how immediately you will get the
Sorry for this. Go ahead, Rituji. I request everybody to please keep muted during when the experts are speaking. Go ahead, ma'am.
Just muted.
Ma'am, Ritu ma'am, you are muted. Yes, go ahead.
So when the child is 5+, because this was one of the question that what is going to happen. So when the child is 5+, that means child is in preschool 3, just before class 1. So your worry was, what is the meaning of preparatory? Whether we should have a preparatory class or not. So my answer is, but it may change also. But as per the new education policy, because I'm telling you, the ministry with other ministries also, because it is clearly written that whatever we are going to do in for early childhood care and education, we should have a collaboration and convergence between different ministries, Ministry of Health, Ministry of Women and Child Development, Ministry of Education, and NCERT, NCTE, NIOS, and other partners. So it will take a little time. So right now, so ab kaisa banke aayega, this we will see. But right now, as per our understanding, private schools, they already have 3 years of free primary education. They need not to open any separate preparatory section for these children. No need for that. Once you will follow NCERT's curriculum, everything is already there. So don't look for any other curriculum. Nothing is going to come. This is the only curriculum that is developed by the NCERT. You may like to follow. I mean, it is just an exemplar, but ministry is not going to develop any curriculum and no other organization. Only NCERT has developed. That is, this is what is existing, even not the Ministry of Women and Child Development. But in future, in the implementation, they might put it, but I don't think this curriculum is a generic, because it is applicable to the private sector also. It is applicable to the government sector also, and to the Anganwadi center also. It's a very modest curriculum. You find it is very easy to implement and easy to understand even by the teacher. So please download it. So what I was telling, that the focus at preschool 3, that is 5+, it will be on preparing children for formal learning, in which the focus will be on early literacy and numeracy. But we cannot neglect all those aspects of the developments. For example, socio-emotional, physical, creativity, these things should not be neglected. But yes, focus should be on developing the literacy and numeracy aspect.
Dr. Chandra, I just want to say that maybe next echo, the next program that we are going to be talking about We are going to be focusing on the basic numeracy and literacy component. And I think maybe, you know, we would request you, since you have explained so well and addressed those questions, we would request you if you could spare some time to spend with us next week also to continue this dialogue. And if you're okay with it, and I think you've done a very, very fabulous job. Why I thank you for spending so much time with us. And at this point, what I'll do is we can continue with this program, and then in the next session, we can then focus on the basic numeracy and literacy part, where we can address the other questions also simultaneously. Is that okay with you, Dr. Chandra?
Yeah, sir, just one more thing that I want to add, but I'm not sure I can come on the next one. I'm not sure, but I'll inform you, sir. But okay. One important thing that I just want to mention here, that I already told you about the key concept, and based on these, how these key concepts can be ensured, we have developed the exemplar pedagogical processes. And the third part of the curriculum is learning outcomes. After, based on the key concept, these are the pedagogical processes. How can you assess the level of the student, whether these key concepts are actually achieved? So the third part is learning outcomes, that actually gives you an idea. Suppose the child is able to tell about, is able to explain the gender, or is able to interact with the unknown person. That means the child is socially competent, and child is able to understand what the child is. So this is the knowing the self, jisko aap kehte hain preschool level pe, knowing the self, knowing and also having the competency to overcome with the stranger anxiety or talking to others. These are the forms of socialization and communication. So there are certain learning outcomes which are given there, and those learning outcomes which are exclusively given at all the stages of preschool 1, preschool 2, and preschool 3, you'll find different learning outcomes which are given in the progression. And the learning outcomes, especially for at the preschool 3 level, that is 5+, are well linked with the learning outcomes of the class 1. So there is no gap. You will not find any gap between the learning outcomes of the preschool 1 between the these two with the class 1. So these are well linked. So once you will go through, you will realize all these things. And management of the classroom, how the children, the assessment of the children will be done, portfolio ke through karenge, or you will observe the child. How will you interact with the parents? How will you involve the parents? Ek bahut aur important baat that I want to say from this platform, this that policy directly nahi likh rahi hai, but the focus, agar aap usko padhte, your questions are also related with those things, that parents ki jahan baat aa rahi, how the parents are going to be involved. So jab hum preschool ki baat kar rahe hain, to school ready, teacher ready, and parents ready, and then the children will be ready. So ye baat, if you read the new education policy in with this concept, then you will easily understand that what is their meaning of writing all these things. So we need to work on school ready, teacher ready, parent ready, and then we can ensure that this child is ready. So this is what I wanted to say. Whatever information you need, you can always write to me. If you want to write my email ID, you can write. My email ID is NCERT. It's NCERT.Ritu, RETU. I'm writing in the chat box.
Yeah, and I think we can also circulate it to all the participants. And at this point, I am very, very honored to see that Professor Khandelwal has also joined us. A lot of you know him. He was the former chairman of CBSE. And after that, he has been heading the growth and academics of DPS Society. And I met him very, very long back. I think it has been long years that I met him. So I'm very happy to see him. And Sangeeta ma'am, I'm going to take some time out, 5 minutes out of you, your time, to let Professor Khandelwal share his views for 5 minutes.
It's an honor for us, yes.
Sir, can you please unmute yourself and share a few words on the policy and especially early childhood?
Am I audible now?
Yes, you're audible, sir.
Okay. So, Dr. Nishwal, thank you very much. I have been seeing you, though we have not met for a long time, but we have been in touch for a long time.
Yes.
And having worked with Hello.
Anu ma'am, you need, yeah. Go ahead, sir.
Yeah. Having served with both these institutions, and then started learning.
Sir, aap mute ho gaye.
I wanted to. I have been in interaction with NCERT and Dr. Ritu through our faculty from DPS, where we have framed a framework. I should not call it a curriculum. I'd like to urge the NCERT to reconsider and not to call it a curriculum. Curriculum has four components. One, syllabus. Number two, the teaching learning practice, that is pedagogy. Three, the supporting material, books, equipments, and et cetera, and fourth is evaluation. Here, in this stage of learning, at this age group, more an experiential learning, in an enjoyable learning, in which we have to be more cautious about the age group, the local contextuality, the mother tongue, and making everything homely. When we call mother tongue, means a feeling of a mother in the teacher also. That is what then makes the linkage more stronger and effective. The child becomes more successful in learning. This is one. The other, my thing was about the languages. Of course, in the public schools, we are teaching through English medium, but language, local language being used. What NCERT and what the policy has emphasized is mother tongue. And that I personally support it with the strong feelings that mother tongue can explain the meaning and feeling of the things much, much more better than explained by the teacher in other language. The other language is something as trained and established later. So this is one very important point. The other is, along with the mother tongue, you can use any language, let it be English, let it be other languages, or in different states, the local region language, along with the mother tongue. This is a point which is very, very, has been made very flexible and not being imposed from anywhere. That is what the local curriculum concept in the policy really means. So we have to be locally contextual. A thing which can be taught in Delhi in a different way referring to nature, while explaining about mathematics, I mean counting or mathematics, smaller or bigger and things like that, to nature, the product, the thing in Srinagar and the thing being taught in Delhi cannot be the same. The different flora, fauna, and the same thing is very applied for different parts of the country. So that flexibility and local context is very important. That's why I submit, and I want to re-emphasize it, and also for our all the brothers and sisters in all the schools, that this should be a competency framework and learning outcome expectancies. That is much more important for us, and that can be charted out based upon the NCERT documents, but for every school by the school teachers. My second and the last point at the moment is, all this what I am saying is not so easily done as it is easily said. What is needed then? Is needed is a training module for our teachers, because 90% of the teachers, I may be more than that, I may be seen more than that, are BAs. We don't have a certification program in early childhood education. The report from the NCT is very clear about it. So here, a training modules or suggested modules can be developed. As Dr. Nishal was referring about, we have tried to do a little bit of research upon this 8 years back, and then developed the practicing modules, and it is 6 months program with face-to-face learning for 15 days, and then stage second and third by getting the feedbacks through the principal, developing certain learning equipments and learning supports, and then to make the systemic observation for growing child and to mark about the developing competencies, tendencies, and the mental and psychological health. That is also very important. So with these words,
thank you so much. Thank you so much for your
thank you, Dr. Nishal. You gave me time.
And I hope that you join us every Friday, sir. मतलब आप एक टाइम हाँ आई टाइम सर हमने इसका नाम फ्राइडे एट 5 इसलिए रखा है आपको भूलेगा ही नहीं हर हर शुक्रवार को 5 बजे आपने यही होना है जहाँ पर इस वक्त हुआ
सर माय माय कोलीग बाला इज विथ यू
यस सर बाला सर इज ऑलवेज विथ मी ही इज द चेयरपर्सन ऑफ आवर एडवाइजरी बोर्ड ही वाज टुडे इन फैक्ट ही केम फॉर सम टाइम I think he is busy in another webinar, so he said that he has some prior commitment. But from the next, I think from the 21st session, he'll be there fully with us.
On early childhood education, whenever you have some, and if I have the message, I will ask a few faculties also to share. Absolutely. Because NCERT people also know them very well.
Bilkul, yes. Sir. Everybody has to be participating. Yes. Thank you so much, sir.
From university otherwise.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Nishal, sir, I want to say something.
Yeah.
This is for Khandelwal, sir. Sir, I'm meeting you for the first time because I know you very well.
But I know about you.
I know, Dr. sir, Shanda, because you made me a part of DPS. Yeah, you made me a part of DPS. it's really very encouraging, and I have really experienced that this the diploma that is being run by the DPS is very, very good, and the whatever are the suggestions given in the new education policy actually are being implemented at this at the DPS level, and you know they train the teachers who are in the primary sections also. So the primary teachers are also being trained in early childhood education, and that is a very progressive approach that they are already using since long, I guess, sir. So
thank you.
So I'm a part of that DPS for the assessment. Do they call me for their demo teaching and assessment? So I really
I'll have to interrupt you here because we'll discuss this. Later on. Have to bring in. Otherwise, we'll. मेरे समोसे ठंडे हो जाएंगे जो मैंने रखे हुए
हैं. जी जी जी.
So let me bring in Sangeeta Krishnan very quickly. Ma'am, we have less time, so you'll have to squeeze your views and yes, your audible.
So good evening. Good evening, everybody. Thank you, Ritu, and thank you, Khandelwal sir, for your views and all the insights that you've shared with us. In fact, we all know that 2020 is a disruptive year for all of us in many, many ways. Our whole life is disrupted with this pandemic. But with this new education policy, we hope that this disruption in the educational scene will be a reformative step in the right direction to meet the future needs of our students. The children who are now in the kindergarten or will be entering kindergarten will be the workforce of the 2030s. And we all know
that India is already a party to the sustainable development goals that have been kind of circulating for a long time now. And we are a party signatory to that. And the NEP actually dovetails into that. As we all know, as Ritu ma'am just shared with us, that the National Early Childhood and Care Curriculum Framework, the quality standards, the policy is already in place. We also have our finance minister this year in May announcing the formation of the National Mission for, what was that? I think it was the National Mission for Educational it was the National Mission for Educational Literacy and things like that, Foundational Literacy and Numeracy. So that, the FLN, and these, there is a budget for that. Now, keeping that in mind, it's very interesting to see that this education, Ritu, am I right, that this national, the Foundational Literacy and Numeracy Mission, the National Mission, will be really is dovetailing into the NEP's vision. So actually, yes. The government...
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, the government is already putting the keystones in place. And it is so important that this foundational literacy and mission and numeracy mission must take into account, must have some clear goal setting and a common understanding of the well-defined indicators to measure foundational skills such as word recognition and oral reading fluency. See, on one hand, while in our public schools, the so-called private schools, which we refer to as public schools, we have done a reasonably good job on getting these basic skills for the child in place. But, you know, when we look at the ASSA report or we look at the PISA reports, they are dismal for the country. And therefore, it is very imperative that the early childhood, the ECCE model be put in place and all stakeholders must be involved. So the 0 to 3, the first substandard, the first sub-framework that is being developed or is being developed by NCERT, and the second framework from grades, from the nursery to grade 2. Now, these two frameworks are very, very critical. While the second framework is something that concerns all of us in the school space, you know, and we are mostly looking at it from 3 years to 8 years and how it's going to be. It is the first framework also, which is very, very critical. And I'm sure Ritu and her team are doing a lot of work on that. And, you know, this is so important because in this, while Mr. Jain said very rightly, he said that it has to be left to the family. But we also need to remember that, you know, the family very often focuses on the social emotional development, which is very key to the child's development, cannot be overlooked. But also the cognitive development of the child is very critical. The child's brain, we all know, develops the most from 0 to 6 years old. And these first 3 years for cognitive development are also critical. So how the government will put these Anganwadis and the non-clustered day schools and the families together to get the mothers and the families involved in the developmental milestones of the child are very important. Now, there are many models available across the globe. For the age group of 3 to 8, the Peru model, the Singapore model have all worked very well. The Scandinavian model, you know, where they have very clearly defined the learning indicators for literacy, for numeracy. For example, in the Peru model, students have to fluently read 60 words per minute by the end of class 2 and 90 words per minute by the end of class 3. Now, these are, you know, very important parameters to judge how well our children are able to read, because reading is an important skill for their future skills also. The government must consider adopting a similar model and spreading awareness about the importance of the fluency, the foundational learning and numeracy skills, such as with the community, especially with the parents. They need to be mobilized proactively. How the government will do that? How are we going to involve parents not only in the cities, but also in the villages, in the remote rural areas, where mothers themselves do not know much, but we need to mobilize them proactively to participate in the children's learning journey. And this is going to be a very, very key contributing factor to this mission's success. it is also important that we take up things like certain pedagogical frameworks which have been developed by NCERT very seriously. Even in the private schools, we realize that, you know, in the mushrooming play schools, the focus is so much on getting the child to know the alphabet, to know the numbers without understanding them. So I think this framework will help everybody to come together to understand things in a better perspective. Now, what is it for the schools? What is it for the parents? What is it for the teachers? And ultimately the product, the child. What does it all entail? This is very, very important. You know, for the schools,
Samsung, these are all bulky phones only.
Hello?
Sorry.
I'll continue. So for the educators and the school promoters, you know, most of us sitting here are the school leaders. Now we have to follow the curriculum and framework formed by the NCERT, developed on the basis of the latest research of the ECCE and the national and international best practices. Within our own country, like Khandelwal sir just said, that there are such good practices. Ritu has also acknowledged the role of the diploma of the DPS, where such good practices have been put in place. And this has to be kind of disseminated all across. And then for the parents, now it's a very important role in the ECC of the parents, which we are not yet talking about, but we really need to be a little more serious about that. Is a professionally designed and administered ECC curriculum, which will ensure holistic development and that children develop foundational literacy and numeracy. So parents have to be involved with the child's learning. At the early childhood, it is the greater involvement of the parent. And of course, for the child, the ECCE brings in, you know, the NEP brings in art, stories, poetry, songs, you know, and the local traditions. So it's going to be a mode, you know, we always talk of joyful learning. I think the NEP brings in a lot of joyful learning for the child right from preschool to grade two. So I think let's focus on the NEP in a very positive manner. Of course, there are apprehensions and we cannot miss those apprehensions out. You know, and every time when I'm very buoyant, honestly, when I'm very buoyant about the NEP, something that comes to my mind, and I've shared with Atul and Lataji earlier also, is that I keep my fingers crossed. Because the NEP, though a great document, a great policy document, a wonderful initiative, should not die the death that we saw of another very wonderful initiative, the CCE. So friends, I would request all of us to come together and take a positive step together, make this new dream, this new opportunity that has come our way, to make it come true, you know, make the most of it, and let us attend to building a top educational system, an opportunity to change the educational scenario in our country, and maybe an opportunity to change the world. With, you know, more humane human beings that will be out in the workforce of 2030. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very, very much. Without wasting much of her time, let me invite Lata ma'am to address us. Ma'am, I'm really sorry we have not much time, and I don't want Dr. Majumdar to run away because we exceeded our time limit. So Lata ma'am, all yours.
Okay. What's happening? Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Yeah. All right, great. Okay, first of all, I thank you, Atul, and thank you. It was wonderful to see Dr. Khandelwal here. Of course, Ritu, the young researcher in the whole team, I think set the context for today's discussion. A lot of lovely questions which have come up from people who have been reading this, and a lot of it has been said and answered. So there's really very little scope for me to add. But I want to say something. When we look at early childhood education, care and education, one thing we should not forget, that there was a loud noise about 20 years back, which said, Basta Hatao, Bachpan Bachao, coming from the then UGC chairman. And I want to say that since then, the interest of the people in early childhood care and education has really taken a big leap forward. And it's, I want to just go back a little to, understand, to help people understand what were the problems with our ECC. You know, whether it was a 68 policy, whether it was the 86 policy, and now 34 years later, we have got this brilliant policy in front of us with a lot of question marks. But that it has been done with the proposal that this will go through a lot of debate and discussion. It has been framed by Kasturi Ranganji, I think, with a lot of consultation, and therefore the document seems to be very broad focused. So it is, the three key elements would be people, policy, people, and process, which would be involved in making this policy come true and alive. Now, when I say this, I want to draw everyone's attention to the UNCRC way back in 1992, when we had the Education for All, because whether it was Education for All then, way back in 2012, or now, being a signatory, as my colleague just mentioned, that we are also signatories to the new, what is it, to the 14 rules of our sustainable development goals. So when we look at this together, I think we need to understand that we have a long road ahead, but the milestones seem to be in place. Now, if we look back at what were our problems, you know, the ECC refers to a range of processes and mechanisms that sustain us and support development of the entire age group, actually from 0 to 8, as they say now, which includes the physical, the emotional, the social, the intellectual, along with the healthcare and nutrition. It also refers to a whole lot of problems that this country went through, and let us for sure understand that this policy document which has come is called national, and most of us who are sitting around and listening to this conversation that we are having amongst ourselves, our school leaders and teachers who are actively engaged, perhaps mostly from the private sector. But we need to understand that there are millions of children out of the system, and the policy is trying to address it in a very significant way. So what were some of the problems? I think they were put under three different headings. There is assessment of quality of ECC on the basis of standards developed by the NWCD. There was also identification of major challenges and quality reforms that were required. And then the possible enablers to reach out for making sure that all these issues will be addressed. So in the early childhood thing, one thing was coming very clearly, that there had to be an interaction child to child, child to teacher, and child to material, environmental and cultural, all of which probably has a positive deviance over the overall development that helps them in formal education as they enter the mainstream schooling. Now, what was it that ailed the system? Well, some of the features that ailed the system were the poor environment, inadequate material, and improper management by the less informed Anganwadi workers who were trying to help this early education. And let me tell you, we are not finding fault with any systems. And as Ritu rightly pointed out earlier, I think all of this is contained in and I would swear by the 2005 National Curriculum Framework, and there is going to be only some minimal changes, and the NCRT framework, which has worked together with all the other agencies, is a really beautiful document. And if you read that, neither is there a problem with the curriculum, as in its pedagogy, as in its assessments, as in its outcomes. And if we follow that, age-appropriate development processes are well-defined. There's going to be very little improvement or addition to this. And anyway, education is a very dynamic one. And as rightly they say, the bridge was built over waters which have changed its course. And therefore, nothing which was yesterday's 100% can be followed today. So now, what were the other problems that the country faced with respect particularly to the ECC when we look at the nation at large, with still millions of children out of the schooling system? Is that our national developmental index? So these are things which we need to think about, because if each one of us is a school leader, and if each one of us is looking at this development and the success of this document by our turn, then we need to see how are we going to peer mentor, how are we going to adopt schools, how are we going to be an influencer in the areas where we can see that development is not happening. And those, I think, will be our contributions. So what are the problems? There was health and nutrition, personal care and routine issues. There was absenteeism, dropouts, class repetitions, age-appropriate teacher-student ratios in these schools. And of course, they tried their best to move it from 40 to 25, which is also an ambition of the current policy. There was absolutely nothing in terms of competency rating or learning outcomes and documentation, adaptation of good practices, all of which is contained in the documents, but not in practice. We now, in this policy, I'm hoping that this will actually take a turn to make sure that all of those will happen. I want to just now spend a few minutes with you on what were some of the significant features of this document. You know, when they say they have put for themselves a target that by 2030, all children will be in schools. The enrollment would be almost complete. So please look at the larger picture and see if that is happening. And please be an influencer in making that happen, because we are not ready to lose a single child. And all of us know that until the age of 6, more than 85% of the brain's development actually happens. And that has been established by many researchers. Now, I think, and there is this need, therefore, that by the time, if these children get into proper schooling, they will be school ready. With only one problem that we must all think about, that when we say school ready, we don't have to necessarily push the frontiers which are not age appropriate in terms of extraordinary focus on literacy and numeracy alone. I think those will come with age appropriateness in the next classes. At this stage, we have to see whether all the developmentally appropriate areas have been addressed. And towards that, I think the real focus has to be on the outcomes of all the developmental areas, whether it is physical, whether it is cognitive, whether it is aesthetic, socio-emotional, emotional. I think all of us know the framework. Now, in this framework, therefore, there is a little difference. We cannot always be sticking to readiness for the next. Although in our Balvatika, we have talked about readiness to class one, because in the structure of the 5 years foundational, because this is a 5+3+3+4 system, in the 5 years, call it by any nomenclature, as Ritu explained very clearly, we have 1+1+1 Balvatika plus class one and class two, being a little more formal area, the one and two, and together they make the foundation. And I was listening to some other experts on early childhood care and education, who said one thing very clearly, that in the developmental format, it is not readiness, it is growth, a systematic growth. And in trying to match standards, let us not put them as a downward extension of our senior classes. That point has to be kept in mind, because all education today, you know, sometimes we, if I take a full leap and say why these 100 marks matter, it's because of admissions to the next higher level. Let us not make ECC in its developmental format, take it away and say that this is readiness 100%. And pull down what I call the downward extension of the higher classes. That should not happen. It should be a natural developmental foundation level literacy and numeracy in the classes one and two, which have appropriately been added to our first foundational years. I think it's a great move, because it also gives, like some experts have pointed out, something very significant. It gives a lot of time. It gives a good 5 years for anybody who is lingering behind to appropriate themselves and be ready. And those small differences which accompany their genetic constitution are well identified and nurtured without fear or frolic of judgment. Therefore, that's completely critical. Also, it sometimes identifies any kind of difficulties of growing up as in special children, their special needs, and gives a good framework for identification of these children and making sure that all the classes can accommodate diversified learning, differentiated learning, so that we can address all of this together. I think it has been addressed. I don't really need to go into these details, but I like the idea of the NP, the National Curricular Pedagogical Framework for Early Child Care and Education. I understand that NCRT has done a lot of work. They're going to have two sub-frameworks of 0 to 3 and 6 to 8. 4 to 8, you know, in the 0 to 3, as Mr. Jain rightly pointed out, my sense is that, like, today we have campaigns for polio vaccines, right? Making sure that not a single child is left behind. They may be just advocacy, there may be campaigns, there may be routine announcements of, through the various media, social media and electronic media, for how to make, you know, right from breastfeeding of children to how to make them grow in an atmosphere which is healthy for the children. I think those will be the areas on the earlier framework, and the correct curricular framework will be thereafter. So while they're putting in their effort, also because the ministries have come together, you know, the Family, Women and Child Welfare Ministry has come together, the Health and Family Welfare Ministry has come together, the Tribal Ministry has come together, and I wish I had also heard things like the Sports and Skill Ministries to come together in the educational framework, because somewhere later they talk about things like apprenticing, etc. However, that's another aspect. Now, the overarching goal of the ECC across the country in a phased manner is to make sure that there is universal access, which I've already pointed out. And therefore, if you look at the framework as it exists now, and which is going to be strengthened, is that there are standalone Anganwadis, then there are Anganwadis with preschools, then there are Anganwadis with and preschools with primary schools. So they're going to make all of this possible, and they're also going to make sure that I really hope it does, because I have had the opportunity to visit these Anganwadis and make sure that, you know, I understand what it really means. And when I look at what it really means, I think I'm very concerned that some of the infrastructure that we see there is not good enough. Friends, I think not to dwell too much on it, we are hoping that there'll be attention on well-ventilated, healthy atmosphere for children to grow through these Anganwadis, and therefore it naturally moves on to the next level, which is training. And what I liked about training, that these systems already exist. We have to strengthen these systems. So the Anganwadi workers, when I visited some of them, I found that there are teachers, and, you know, we have this misconception that there are very small children there. I found children out of school right from 3 years to 12 years coming there only for the midday meal schemes. And therefore, this document which we are seeing now, saying that not only will you give them lunch, but please give them a healthy breakfast, so that in a healthy body can there be healthy learning. And I really, really hope that someday we'll be able to say, not very far away from now, that these schools which are providing the early childhood care for across, when it comes to us and private schools, we hardly question these, which we take for granted, because we have the resources, infrastructure resources, manpower resources, we have all kinds of material resources which can make it successful. Let's really hope that no child is left behind. And that is a concern which we need as senior educators to look into and feel good about. How are they going to therefore train these people to do better? I like the fact that there'll be a digital mode, in distance mode. So I'm seeing that, you know, there's some transfer of learning in the new normal is going to be incorporated, because the pandemic and the new policy seem to share and race for its prime position. And I really hope both of them win. In addition to this, they've talked of cluster resource centers that will come up. They've talked of, contact programs where they will be assessed and once again put through training. So these are young people of 10 plus 2 or even lower. 10 plus 2 have a 6-month certification. The lower people will have a 1-year certification. There'll be others who will go through more training. The real question, however, is that in the policy framework itself, they're talking of a 2-year B.Ed. system. I'm wondering whether there is a natural preparation, not just this 2-year B.Ed. program or 1-year B.Ed. program or even less, all options have been given. Does it really include and focus on early childhood education as well? Because if that requires transfer, if that requires enlargement, engagement and reform, so does all these areas where you can hardly see anything happening. So I wish that training is going to be capacity development, professional development, the private schools, whether it is DPS Society, whether it is any other group, there are hundreds of groups of absolutely ambitious and wonderful educators who are making their own frameworks and making it very well. So with that, I want to say that I'm also impressed that, you know, a lot of emphasis is going to be provided to the tribal areas. It's really beautiful to see. And I love the word ashram shalas. These are people who have never left their civilization. In fact, I was told that there is a community, I'm sorry, I hope I'll be proved wrong, and fought over by people for this. I was told that there is a community somewhere in the Nilgiris, and southern states are reasonably okay with their government systems over there. I've heard people say that the tribal areas, some of them don't know that they live in an independent country. You know, friends, those are our areas. We cannot live in ivory towers. Smoke will rise to the top, and therefore the policy has to be seen in a much bigger framework. And I do hope that along with this, there is one, I'm very happy that they've also set up the NPST, you know, the National Professional Standards for Teaching. And that by 2022, the NCRT, SCRT, and the practicing and experts will come together to make sure that the National Professional Standards for Teachers will be given a push, and there will be something. My only question again is ECC a part of it? Please push the frontiers wherever this advocacy is possible, because I'm going to do it. Because if there is a professional standards for teachers, I think that should also take care of this very critical phase where we say 85% of the development actually happens out there. And of course, the performance assessment review and analysis for holistic development cannot leave ECC out. So PARAC, the National Assessment Center, must provide us guidelines and must consider ECC a very significant part for the developments. And I think together with the dreams of the NITI Aayog, the MHRD, the UNESCO, and the World Bank, which rates states for the learning outcomes, we will be able to reach some global benchmarks. And there are hundreds of examples, but very often, hundreds of examples should not be mistaken for what were left behind. Let's all work together and let's develop twinning programs, be influencers in education, because every one of you who is listening into this lovely program put together by Atul, I think it's a Friday evening, food for thought. Am I taking one more together to school? Can I be an influencer? Can I be sharing my material? Can I help in the capacity building of my neighborhood? Because when smoke rises to the top of our houses, the ivory towers will get destroyed. I think I'm extremely hopeful that the new education policy will, in its entirety, but with this huge sector, you know, the best news is that we have 6% GDP on this. And I'm really hoping that if I were to break it up, the real focus, which is different from other national policies, is on the focus on ECC. And if ECC is going to be 5 years, the most critical period where food is required, where nutrition is required, where health is required, where training of teachers, young teachers, parents are required, and whether there is total involvement of parents and the community, because it takes a whole village to raise a child. And is this a proper environment for my 2-year-old, for my 3-year-old, for my 5-year-old, not just the privilege of everyone? The national policy is food for thought for all of us. Very happy that it's in place together. And as we'll find vaccines, so also we'll find solutions.
Thank you. Let me invite Dr. Mazumdar. A lot of us know him as a sports journalist and the professor's autobiography. But we I think my voice is echoing. So a lot of us might not know that at the depth of his heart, he's an academic. He cares a lot about education, very passionate about education. He's a faculty of sports and welfare, well-being, and associated with quite a few foreign universities. I would invite Dr. Majumdar to say a few words to the entire audience. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Atul. Thank you, everybody. I mean, it is not my forum to speak, actually. It is my forum to listen. And that's what I did. And I was here in three capacities. The first capacity was as a parent. And a lot of the focus was on how parents need to deal with this new policy. And here I speak as a parent of a six-year-old who is actually working in front of me at the moment, trying to grapple with this new process of online education. So it was instructive, educative, and a lot of learning for me. So Lataji and the rest of you, you've actually educated me over the last 1.5 hours, and I'm delighted for that. Number two, as someone who is interested in education, having taught in multiple universities across the world, I was trying to grapple with my own set of challenges as far as this new education policy is concerned. And again, you have helped clarify doubts. And number three, and here I think this is important. Each of you have addressed a number of things. Is there one India? I don't think there is one India. There are 200 Indians. Can there be one size fits all? I think you have addressed that also. I think all of these questions that are relevant to the new education policy and child development has been addressed over the last 1.5 hours. But what is pertinent for me to say here are two things. One, ICSL and the role played by Friday at 5. What is the purpose of this program? The purpose of this program is to become the umbrella which will provide constructively critical voice as a think tank, which will perhaps create synergy between the public and private sector and create white papers that in future will perhaps help policymaking with government. That, I think, is what you guys were doing over the last 1.5 hours. If this was recorded and if this is put out as a paper to the MHRD or to the other ministries who have contributed to it, I think serious service would have been done to the country. Number two, if all of these deliberations are subsequently written out, and this is a significant issue, you know, with online learning, what are we doing? We are giving our children mobile phones, smartphones, and computers. And the second instant, we are telling them, oh, you know what? Do not look at mobile phones, go read. So there is a disruption happening there as well for me as a parent. If I'm empowered, and I am, I've got an Oxford PhD, I've taught in 10 different universities, I don't know what to tell my daughter who's a six-year-old, goes to a private school because I can afford that. So these are important questions that, because of the disruption caused by COVID and the disruption to a degree caused by the new education policy, all of us are grappling with. And that's where ICSL and Friday at 5 can make a significant difference. I think this is a think tank. Each of you guys are key cog of that think tank. I think this think tank can influence Indian policymaking. And like you said, somebody came from Sharjah, we can initiate a global dialogue. We can understand, assimilate, appropriate, absorb the better things from other education systems, start a global dialogue, and end up empowering our teachers, end up empowering our parents, and finally empower our children. Someone said teachers, students, schools. I think you said school, you said parent, and you said something else. You left out the child. Even a child of 3 to 6 has to be empowered. Because each of these people, and don't take us as the model, these people are profoundly different. They have their say at the age of 5 and 6. And that's what we have to do as a country. Like Lataji, I think, said, 85% of the brain is formed by 6. So you've got to take that into account. And that, I think, is what ICSL is doing. So commendable effort, Atul. What we need to do is become more structured, become more timely, become more focused maybe, give people the scope to use this platform better, and record each of these conversations and write them out, so that the country as a whole can benefit. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Mujibur. And I think we are recording this session, but as you said, we need to also bring this content into a more structured form, I totally agree with you. Even at the end of 90 minutes, you know, we have about 300 people who are still with us. And I think that's a 90% retention rate, I think, is phenomenal when we are speaking about non-sports and non-cricket and non-Bollywood things. We are talking purely early childhood. So I think we have a lot of dedicated people who are with us on this platform. And I hope, as a closing remark, I hope that all of you come back to us next week, Friday at 5 o'clock. We're going to be talking about in detail about basic numeracy, and we're going to be talking about literacy, basic literacy. And we hope that you join us for a continuous weekly session so that we can, as Dr. Majumdar said, that we can make a difference, not within our schools, but I think we need to make a difference at a national level, and which is something that we would love to do and we would aim to do. So thank you very much, all of you, for being there, asking wonderful questions. I want to thank all the experts who shared their views, and I hope they continue to be on this platform. Till then, have a great weekend, and hopefully we'll see all of you back Friday at 5 next week. Thank you.